depressions in history. Once again outraged, Congressman Lewis McFadden, a longtime opponent of the banking cartels, began bringing impeachment proceedings against the Federal Reserve Board, saying of the crash and depression, "It was a carefully contrived occurrence. International bankers sought to bring about a condition of despair so that they might emerge the rulers of us all." Not surprisingly, and after two previous assassination attempts, McFadden was poisoned at a banquet before he could push for the impeachment. Now, having reduced the society to squalor, the Federal Reserve bankers decided that the gold standard should be removed. In order to do this, they needed to acquire the remaining gold in the system. So, under the pretense of helping to end the depression, came the 1933 gold seizure. Under the threat of imprisonment for 10 years, everyone in America was required to turn in all gold bullion to the Treasury, essentially robbing the public of what little wealth they had left. And at the end of 1933, the gold standard was abolished. If you look at a dollar bill from before 1933, it says it is redeemable in gold. You look at a dollar bill today, it says it is legal tender, which means it is backed by absolutely nothing. It is worthless paper. The only thing that gives our money value is how much of it is in circulation. Therefore, the power to regulate the money supply is also the power to regulate its value, which is also the power to bring entire economies and societies to its knees.
They create money out of nothing. What a scam. They have so much money, they don't care about money. All they care about is power. All they care about is being able to control the political situation so it goes their way.
After a man has far more money than he possibly can spend for pleasures, what is left to excite him? For those with a ruling class mentality, the answer is power, raw power over other human beings. Money can buy such power only to a point. Beyond that, politics is the sport, and world politics is the ultimate game.
On the outskirts of the national capital today, black limousines with darkened windows converged on a hotel where private security guards imposed ironclad control. The limos carried royalty, political power brokers, and industrial titans to a secret meeting that will last all weekend. It's known as the Bilderberg Group. Could their objective be world domination?
If you haven't heard of the Bilderbergers, it's for one reason only. They haven't wanted you to. At their annual closed-door meetings, no outsiders are allowed even close to the building. Here are gathered the most powerful individuals of the Western world, united regularly at club meetings. Yet nothing is reported by the New York Times, the Washington Post, or the LA Times.
What really fascinates me is the complete blackout in the American press. For more than 20 years, I've gone down to the press club every day. I check the wires in their library. mingled with other paper boys, and I asked them the question many times, why, when if 120 film stars or 120 NFL football players met behind locked and guarded doors at a remote location for 3 days, you'd try very hard to penetrate and find out what those movie stars or football players are doing? Well, I had no curiosity at all when 120 of the world's most powerful financial leaders and political leaders meet for 3 days in a remote location behind armed guards in a complete blackout. Why no curiosity?
The people who call conspiracy theorists are not the conspiracy theorists themselves. We're talking about facts here. The Bilderberg Group does exist. The Federal Reserve does exist. The people who are members of the Bilderberg Group are also the people who do control the Federal Reserve. These are all facts.
In 1954, the elite of the planet met in secret at the Bilderberg Hotel in Oosterbeek, Holland. The Bilderberg Group would later admit that their mission was the formation of the EU. Once the EU was established, under the guise of trade deals, a North American Union and Asian Union would be formed. The three interlocking superstates form the core of the global government, while the United Nations would serve as a world regulatory and enforcement body over the third world subregions. The Bilderberg Group consists of the heads of all of the managing roundtable groups that steer individual countries. Picture the elite power structure of the world as a giant pyramid, with only the elite of the elite at the tip top of the capstone. The group has been so secretive that until the mid-1980s, the controlled corporate media denied its existence. Into the late 1990s, coverage only consisted of rare one-line mentions. With the rise of the alternative media, their stranglehold on information has begun to slip.
What we do hear coming out of those meetings is incredible about the plans of the New World Order to consolidate power. Political power and economic power coming together at the highest level. But what I call the lapdog media, the controlled media in this country, you would think that they would be going to court, crying freedom of information, open meetings, sunshine law, and all of these things, but the silence is deafening.
Why is it the major media would deny this? Let's look at the ownership of the major media. Let's look at the roster of, say, the Bilderberg meeting. Catherine Graham owns the Washington Post. Catherine Graham has been to the Bilderbergers. Conrad Black, one of the largest media barons in Canada and Europe, has not only been to these meetings, but he has hosted the meeting just a few years ago.
Every year they meet in secret, and there is an absolute news blackout. There is never anything reported in any of those papers.
David Rockefeller himself thanked the media for keeping this all hushed up.
First heard about Bilderberg in 1975, and I said, I don't believe it. That's not possible. Who in hell's Bilderberg? I spent 20 happy years with metropolitan newspapers. All the wires are clicking at my ear. That could not happen without me knowing about it. And the thing that first impressed me most was caused in 1957 by the late, great Westbrook Pegler, widely syndicated columnist. He wrote two lengthy columns about how approximately 100